Hi, I'm Brian Farr from Redwood County, and this is Matt Tiffany, a Redwood County farmer here in southwestern Minnesota. And we're out here today. Matt is planting corn into some rye that was planted last fall. So we just want to find out from Matt why he did this and how he went about it. And this was a bean field last year, correct, Matt?
Yep.
If you want to just explain what was the process and to get to this point.
So most of our soybeans are for seed production for a seed company, and we grow some very early maturity soybeans. So our bean harvest is earlier than normal. What that gives us is it gives us a great window to get some covers established, because these were probably harvested the 15th to 20th of September. So we've got a vertical tillage tool with a Valmar seeder on it that we seeded this with. We ran it about an inch deep, so we're not really doing a lot of tillage, just enough to incorporate that seed. That's the way we seeded it. There's a few reasons why. One, you know, when you harvest stuff in early September, double zero early maturity soybeans, one, don't have a lot of residue, and two, we wanted to cover the soil. We know that cereal rye does a really good job in Minnesota with overwintering, coming back in the spring, and a field with relatively little soybean residue had the potential to blow, mainly in the spring is what I looked at. I think history says April is our windiest month, and a lot of times we don't have the snow cover to protect our soil. So why not have some cereal rye growing? And that was kind of why, if you want to look into the water quality end of it, you know, even these little 4-inch tall rye plants, we've seen root growth up to 3 feet within 5 or 6 weeks in the fall. So those roots are down there sequestering or taking up any, mainly nitrogen, that could get into our groundwater that, you know, I paid for it. I didn't pay for it in my soybean crop, but it's something in the soil that has value to me. Why do I want to let it get out of the root zone or into the groundwater when I could have this rye bringing it back up to the surface?
Right, and they say whatever, 20% is what you see. There's another 80% laying around doing its job. Could you tell us when you planted this rye?
Oh, it probably would have been the end of September. Like I said, we started bean harvest last year, September 15th, and this would have been one of our first fields. So it was probably the 26th, 27th of September. And this spring, this spring was different than last spring, but it came out of dormancy early and nice, and we had some good growing conditions early. So
after you planted that at the end of September, did it green up in the fall?
Yeah, we probably had, this was pretty solid green. It was probably a little more thick than it is today. But rye growth in the fall only gets maybe 3-4 inches. And here, if we let this go another 3 weeks, it's going to be to here. So, we had some good fall growth, and it was nice to see that green and see that cover.
And talking with other producers, that's the most critical point, is to get it germinated and green up in the fall before it goes into dormancy. And then we've seen a lot of fields like this that did really no job coming back. But if we did it late and it didn't germ very well, we didn't have very good luck with that. So it's nice to see that if we get it early enough, September, early part of October, we get some growth going. It seems like we've got better storms.
Yeah, we're real pleased with how it works. Typically, if they were a square field, we would plan on side dressing our nitrogen. This is a triangle. You drive over a lot of corn to side dress, and we've got another real odd-shaped field. But for our nitrogen management, we put some on with the planter, and then we actually streamed out a bunch of 32% with Nutrisphere as a stabilizer so square fields, decent rows. We like to side dress and feed that nitrogen 3 times to kind of manage the extra residue we have. But in this case, we didn't want to do that. So the nitrogen, a good chunk of it's been put on this spring with liquid, and then I'll throw on the rest here.
Okay, so when you planted this rye, how many bushels of the acre were you targeting?
We were targeting about one bushel an acre, so 56 pounds. And I think if we were just broadcasting on the surface, we'd go for a little more. The fact that we were incorporating it in some with some soil, we felt that that would be adequate. And in the past, we've been really, really pleased with that one bushel an acre.
So now you said you're planting corn into this. There's a lot of misconception out there, a lot of people that are nervous planting corn into standing rye because it's grass on grass. What do you feel now that you've got this planted? What is your plan now how to terminate this rye after your corn is done?
So we've done both ways with corn and soybeans. We've terminated before and wait until it was, you know, 2 weeks before and it's dead and it's brown and planted. That way works fine. We've terminated or planted green and then terminated after. I think I like planting it green better. One, with the trash wheels on the planter, the brown stuff had a tendency to kind of get caught up in there.
After.
The green does not. You can plant it green and it doesn't wrap at all. So I like planting it green and we're going to terminate it right after with a pre-emerge herbicide to pass. Throw in. I've seen that the smaller rye is actually pretty easy to kill with Roundup. 24 ounces has always done it for us when it's small. 32 ounces last year killed 4 foot tall rye. So we have not had an issue terminating cereal rye.
And some people like a 2-inch green like this. It's taking up a lot of the moisture out of the soil, making the ground. This year we don't have to worry too much because we've had dry conditions, which is odd. But in a wetter year, the people that add rye said it really sucks the moisture out of their ground so they can get in there and crack it too.
Yeah, I saw that last year in some one bean field that had that field called rye. It was the only field I could plant because it was using moisture that allowed me to get out there and actually get something planted. So, but that's our plan to terminate this is after planting the pre-emergent.
Okay. So you're planting corn into this. What is the population you're using on your planting corn?
We're planting at 35,000, which is just our standard rate that we've been planting on a lot of our fields. We vary a little bit just depending on the topography and soil type and stuff. But this field, pretty good producing field if we don't get too much water. Yep.
So, could you give us a little history on this? What was done here before you started doing this, you know, the no-till process and the rye or the minimum tillage? What was done on this field prior to this?
So, we farmed this field or this piece for quite a while. We had been conventional tillage, so after corn, it would have had a disc ripper, and then a field cultivator pass in the spring. After soybeans, would have been a chisel plow, and then a field cultivator pass in the spring. So with this system after the soybeans, it's just that shallow vertical till pass, seeding it, nothing in the spring, and planting. You know, we're cutting out that power, you know, that horsepower intense fall tillage, that primary tillage that sucks a couple gallons of fuel an acre or an hour, and replacing it with a vertical tillage pass and no fuel cultivator.
So have you done any economics from when you were doing conventional to now? Do you have kind of a price per acre that you think you're saving just on the tillage purposes alone?
Well, if you go by Iowa State, you know, custom rates, one field cultivator pass, I think they're at like $15 or $16 an acre just for that pass. Well, if we don't have a field cultivator pass, there's $15 right there. If you are pulling a vertical till tool at 8.5 miles an hour versus a chisel plow at 6.5 or 7, I don't know what you're still making a pass, but it's a cheaper pass. So I would venture to guess we're probably saving $20 an acre just to save tillage passes.
So that's a big part of what we're looking at with farmers is the economics part of that. Have you seen any yield lag by changing to this system, or is it still about the same, but just lower inputs?
I haven't seen a yield lag. I think part of the reason is we, especially planting in the rye, we have the capability of applying some nitrogen with our planter. And people talk talk about the allelopathic properties of rye and how it's going to kill your corn. I kind of tend to think that it's maybe a more of a nitrogen tie-up issue, and having the capabilities of putting some nitrogen on with the platter kind of offsets that. We have not seen a yield loss from the no-till versus the strip-till we do. And actually, the one conventional till field we've had the last couple of years has been our lowest yield in the field. So, and the highest cost, right, which makes us wonder, why do we do that?
Right, so, right. So what is your N rates? Have you seen an increase in organic matter by doing testing out or soil testing?
You know, I'm kind of due now to retest all my fields. This is the fourth year. I'm kind of on a four-year rotation. Okay. So it'll be interesting to see. In the last 4 years, we've adopted a lot more cover crops, shifted solely to strip-till and no-till, to see how that has changed our organic matters. You know, a lot of people give the university studies and recommendations a lot of flack on, oh, they're too low. All the tests I've done have really shown that if we're good enough right within the rates, and I tend to go a little on the lower side. So that said, we do feed our crop usually in three increments. So a little up front, a little with the planter, and then we side dress as well. A lot of it is in season. So with that, I think we can back off the rates a little bit. I don't know that the cover crop is the thing there, other than, you know.
So it'd be interesting to see on your organic matter levels, because we've kind of used that as a rule of thumb. You increase your organic matter by 1%, that's 20 pounds of nitrogen credit. You know, and then, I don't know what N is right now, but that's a substantial. So that's, you know, another thing that we're bringing along, we're finding out, farmers are finding out, just not the tillage you're saving money, but the lower inputs. Do you know what the final grade of N is on this field once you put all your N on?
So this field will have about 140 total, and that's with the three different. Now this one will have two different applications, but it'll be 140 total.
Okay.
And, which is a little higher than some of the others we do.
Okay.
Where we have the strips or where we side dress, we're usually shooting for about 130.
Okay.
And a nitrogen usage rate ratio of about 0.6 to 0.7 is typically where we're at for some pretty decent crops.
So everybody knows, what is the realistic yield goal for this area? What would this field be the realistic yield goal for corn?
For corn, this field minus the wet spot, this would have I'm not sure even what the KPH is, but it's a realistic yield goal would be about 210 to 220. That's pretty, that'll catch this field pretty
good. We felt there was no lag, you know, that 210 is going to be average on the average when you went down to 140.
We have not seen any reason to apply much to more in. That's not our limiting factor. Usually our limiting factor is water. Too much or not enough. And that's been, too much has been the case the last couple of
years. Yeah, this is very nice to get in there with a farm plant in April.
So, even thinking about planting in April is a welcome change.
Right. Well, we want to thank Matt for his time today and explain why he does some of this, and we're going to probably do interviews with Matt throughout the season, but we just wanted to give a heads up that I'm corn and rye, and we want to thank Matt for his time, and so we can get him back in the planter.
Now you're welcome.